Thank you so much for having me here with you tonight. I moved here from Williamsburg about 10 years ago. In fact, just over 10 years ago. Of all the things that I am and that I may be, I have to begin by confessing that I am not actually a proper historian. So I'm afraid that I actually stand before you in the shadows rather than on the shoulders of the men and women who have graced this podium before me. In the next hour, however, I hope to circumvent that fundamental shortcoming by sharing with you the results of my ongoing reflections and musings on my own ancestor, Henry Clay, and his legacy of statesmanship in America. From the time I was little, I was aware that I was a Henry Clay descendant, but initially that didn't really make sense to me. I didn't know who he was or what that meant. I knew that he had been Secretary of State. I knew that he had been a senator. He'd been a congressman. He'd been Speaker of the House. He had negotiated the Treaty of Ghent. And yet, none of that really made sense to me. The one thing that I continuously heard and knew was that he was a great statesman. That meant even less to me than all the other things. I really couldn't understand what statesmanship meant, but I knew that if I was speaking to an adult, I'd mention Henry Clay, the great American statesman. And that seemed to pacify everyone, much as Henry Clay liked to pacify his fellow colleagues in the House and the Senate. And he'd earned the nickname the Great Pacificator and the Great Compromiser by taking tremendous steps to keep our country together in the first half of the 19th century. But as I've grown up and begun to work in circles in which he actually worked, I have grown increasingly fond of my connection to Henry Clay, and I have come to revere his legacy more and more by the day. I want to share a little bit about him just to get us all on the same page, to make sure that we're talking about the same person from an almost resume standpoint, but then put a little bit of meat on the bones and talk about Henry Clay as a person and what made him so compelling as a character throughout the first half of the 19th century. And then I want to share with you some of my musings on what statesmanship actually means, because it is a term that gets thrown around a lot and rarely defined. And I have become a big fan of defining terms, and I'll tell you a little bit about that as we get along. Finally, I'll open up the floor to what I hope will be both a series of questions, and hopefully I'll have some answers, but also I'd like a discussion, if we could, on what statesmanship means to all of us, because I think there is a personal component to it as well. And hopefully we will have a lively discussion that will continue beyond this room as the evening unfolds. As Henry Clay and I share ancestry, I will start by saying that our forebear, Captain John Clay, arrived in Jamestown in 1613. His nickname was the English Bombardier and actually came from Monmouth in Wales, where my family had been for several centuries after being granted a large parcel of land by the monarch. It was about 150 years before anyone from the Clay family really left Virginia. And in that time, the Clay family developed as a strong and visible member of the planter class, which meant that they owned slaves and they owned property. And it was in that environment that Henry Clay was born on April 12, 1777, less than a year after we declared independence from Britain. The Revolutionary War was ongoing, and Henry Clay was only 3 years old when the British troops ransacked his home in Hanover County, Virginia. And it was only a year later that his father, Reverend John Clay, died, leaving his mother to look after their seven children. And that's seven of originally nine, as I believe two had already deceased by that point. Elizabeth Clay, Henry's mother, saw to it that despite the hardship, Henry was going to get an education. And he was educated in a log cabin with a dirt floor by an Englishman who had to leave England under cloudy circumstances. And he was very fond of that education, despite having, not surprisingly, a negative view towards Britain, given what had happened when he was 3 years old. Henry took to his teacher and learned a tremendous amount at school, and did very well at school, even while balancing his duties at home. And those duties included going to the mill routinely in Hanover County, which is often called the Slashes, which earned him the nickname Mill Boy of the Slashes, a title that actually played heavily in his political campaigns of the future. So as Henry grew up, his mother remarried, and his loving stepfather, who looked after him very well, saw to it that he be given as much opportunity as possible to succeed. And at the age of 19, his stepfather arranged for him to work in Richmond for Chancellor George Wythe. Now, George Wythe had already served from 1790 onwards as the first professor of law in America at my own alma mater, the College of William and Mary. So educated in the same tradition as Henry Clay, I'm particularly keen to bring up the Wythe education, but it was also very formative for Henry. Wythe had not only educated the men and boys who had moved through William and Mary over the years, he had been Thomas Jefferson's own mentor and John Marshall's own mentor. So Wythe's legacy was tremendous already on some of the key figures of our early years. And Henry was educated in that tradition by George Wythe. In 1797, he passed the Virginia bar, something which I can attest is quite a feat. And looking at his prospects, realized that he had an opportunity to move out to Lexington, Kentucky, where there was a blooming and burgeoning legal market. Kentucky was a new frontier, and as a result, there were all kinds of land and title and property disputes that were keeping lawyers very busy and well employed. And so he went out and found his way in Lexington into a legal practice and began very quickly to have success. He also had a tremendous success socializing in Lexington, and within 2 years of arriving, married the daughter of one of Lexington's wealthiest businessmen, Lucretia Hart. Henry married Lucretia at quite a young age and stayed married to her his entire life. She outlived him, and together they ultimately had 11 children, not many of whom survived to adulthood, but I certainly thank goodness for the one that did. So as Henry began to build his life in Lexington, he garnered a reputation for being affable, likable, but also quite intense and firm. He was not to be trifled with. And his legal practice took on a completely different league when in 1906, he ended up representing Aaron Burr. Aaron Burr, a major political figure, an historical figure, had been accused of launching an illegal expedition into Spanish-held territories out west. And Henry Clay was convinced that he was innocent, and so actually represented him successfully in court and defended him. And so he was always convinced of that innocence until years later. Thomas Jefferson actually convinced him that he was not innocent and that Henry had made a terrible mistake, at which point Henry became a huge enemy of Aaron Burr's and was very angry about that. And I think that shows some of the character he brought to the practice, because he really sought to take on cases in which he believed. And as a result, he did very well. He was quite convincing. He became a very good orator in court. He was very convincing both to the judge and to juries, and people liked him. And so in 1803, actually before the Aaron Burr trial, he found his way into public life for the first time. He was elected to the Kentucky General Assembly, made such an impression at quite a young age that in 1806, just after the Aaron Burr trial, he was selected by the legislature to fill an empty seat that was made available by John Breckinridge. John Breckinridge was at that point made Attorney General. And as a side note, it's actually quite interesting to look at a bigger picture, because several generations later, the Clays and the Breckinridges married. Henry Clay's great-granddaughter, from whom I am not directly descended, Madeline McDowell, married a Breckinridge and became Madeline McDowell Breckinridge and became leader of the suffragist movement. So it's a very interesting tie-in that Henry Clay's first entry into to the Senate ended up being somewhat tied to his later years, his legacy several generations later. But his first bit of a first term in the Senate was unremarkable. But when he came back to Kentucky, he was a bit more practiced in the art of politics by that point and ended up being elected Speaker of the House of the Kentucky General Assembly. And it was in that role that he really showed how much he was committed to his principles and to his views, in that he actually went and fought a duel with one of his political opponents over an issue. and so fiercely determined not to sully the soil of Kentucky with blood, they crossed the river and fought the duel in Indiana. Now, neither of them died. Henry Clay managed to shoot his opponent in the chest, but not fatally, and he took a bullet in the thigh himself. But he was willing to draw his pistol in pursuit of his convictions. Slightly crazy, but certainly remarkable in how much he cared about his views. He filled another short Senate term in 1810, but it was in 1811 that he was first elected to the United States House of Representatives, and this is where his career really gets interesting. He is the only person to have ever been elected Speaker of the House on his first day as a congressman. And he is credited with really turning that role, the role of the Speaker of the House, into what it is today, a major position of great influence. As Speaker of the House, he advocated in 1812, not surprisingly given his history with the Brits, that we enter the war. Somebody brought up that he was a war hawk, and he was. He was firmly committed that we needed to go to war with Britain to clarify where we stood as a country. There were several things that we fought the war over. Most people forget them. They're pretty easily forgettable because 2 years later, after we'd sort of spent most of our treasure fighting in Canada, fighting out west, fighting in the south, we ended up negotiating a treaty with Britain that brought everything back to where it was before the war. So status quo antebellum. And it's interesting that Henry Clay was such an adamant war hawk, and yet he was also one of the principal negotiators of that treaty. I had the opportunity this past year, thanks to Ashland, the Henry Clay estate, to which he moved in 1806, to actually go to Ghent and to walk around and follow in Henry Clay's footsteps during the process of negotiating that treaty. And I'll come back to this in a bit, but it was fascinating to me to see that he had left an imprint there that people actually talk about day to day and still remember as a sort of collective memory. And we'll get into to some of the more enjoyable anecdotes in a few moments, but I flagged that as an interesting turning point in his career, because I think he came back from that trip with slightly new perspectives. When he returned, he ended up actually in the Senate again as part of what is still known as the Great Triumvirate. Henry Clay, Prince Harry, Harry of the West, represented the Western component of America. Daniel Webster of Massachusetts represented the North, and John C. Calhoun of South Carolina represented the South. Those three great statesmen, despite differing views, differing backgrounds, differing temperaments, managed to work together in a sort of strange partnership to really drive forward a lot of the policies that have actually endured through this day. Henry Clay was adamant about creating what he called the American system. He wanted a network of roads and financial institutions and transportation infrastructure that would connect the various states, maintaining their rights, but at least integrating them into a fully functional union. And that, I think, today is still a goal that we need to continue working towards achieving, but it is something that he really pushed hard and ended up becoming a defining element of his political career for years to come. In 1817, perhaps also influenced by some of what he experienced abroad, he became, oddly, a Latin American hero by advocating independence movements in Latin America. Incidentally, Venezuela still considers him a national hero, as he was, in his influential position in America, quite influential in helping the Venezuelans gain independence as well. In 1820, Henry Clay was the architect of the famous Compromise of 1820, or Missouri Compromise, that helped stave off some of the frustrations and tensions that would ultimately lead to the Civil War. And in 1824, Henry Clay became the ninth Secretary of State. Unfortunately, he became Secretary of State under somewhat unfortunate circumstances because of what was known as a corrupt bargain, where he threw his weight behind John Quincy Adams in his role as Speaker of the House of Representatives. Many felt that he had not earned the position of Secretary of State. And that ultimately, I believe, cost him the presidency because he ended up running for president 5 times, failing all 5, and becoming famous for his quote, "Well, I'd rather be right than president." In 1833, he began. He came back to his sort of role as a great compromiser, and again brought the country from the brink, where he managed to get South Carolina to back off its move towards secession under a tariff compromise that kept things together for a while. And in 1850, after several unsuccessful attempts at retirement, he came back into public life to help negotiate the Compromise of 1850, which kept the country together for just a few more years. Henry Clay died in June of 1852 at the age of 75. I think it's interesting to look at some of the biographies that were written of him. They were written at different times throughout his life. And throughout, they call him a great statesman, but they all remark of what a fascinating character he was. And so with that sort of resume of Henry Clay, I want to sort of make this a bit more fun and a bit more casual, because Henry Clay was fun. He was liked by everyone. He was not a great-looking guy, but he was beloved by the ladies. He was always out, ready to have a good time. And as much as that sounds like he was just a jokester or a prankster or a drunkard or a card shark, he used that affability and that congeniality as part of his service. He really made it hard for people to hate him. They might not agree with him. They might actually really hate what he had to say. But at the end of the day, he managed to keep people together in a way that we don't often see. When I was in Ghent in December, it was fascinating because almost everybody I talked to said, Treaty of Ghent, 200 years, yes. We loved the Americans. They were great fun. They actually had a great relationship with us. The Brits, however, stayed far away in a place way outside of town and didn't really interact at all. But apparently the Americans came out drinking and partying and having a good time all the time. And I was like, yes, that would be Henry Clay. There are stories from John Quincy Adams' diaries and his letters to his wife during the time in Ghent, which I think epitomized how Clay behaved, in that Quincy Adams, a Puritan, couldn't stand Henry Clay for much of it. Henry Clay was coming home as John Quincy Adams was waking up to start his prayers and his study. He was out every night, and I actually got to even go into some of the bars that still exist where he went. It was great fun. But what was so interesting was the legacy that delegation left was this sort of very friendly, enjoyable, congenial group. And ultimately, John Quincy Adams came around to realize that there was great value in what Henry Clay was doing, that he was building such an incredible relationship and such a personal relationship with the people in Ghent, that he wrote that our relationship with the townspeople is our guard of honor. And that was in contrast to the Brits, who needed to keep a red centurion out in front of their gates at all times to keep themselves protected. And I won't draw too direct of a parallel to today, but it certainly makes you think about perhaps where we are today in terms of force protection and diplomatic security, and whether we are approaching things in quite the right way. I'll park that. But Henry Clay used to, every time he came from Kentucky to Washington, bring with him a barrel of bourbon. Somebody mentioned bourbon, and it was actually integral to his experience as a politician and as a statesman. Bourbon was not what he used to get drunk, it's what he used to get others drunk. he shared it, and the way he put it was, he brought his barrel of bourbon with him from Kentucky to Washington to lubricate the wheels of government. And he understood that actually sharing a drink and having a good time with somebody made it a lot easier to work with them. And it made it easier to get past positions and towards interests and to actually find out what people cared about. And I think that's what I started to realize that he was doing. And he had all kinds of facades. He used to show up with multiple female dates, young female dates, none of which were his wife, to events. There is no evidence he ever actually cheated on his wife, but he was always surrounded by girls and having a good time. And despite that sort of playboy facade, he really was quite a serious negotiator. He was firm, he was tough, he was willing to fight a duel, he was willing to put aside his personal views and get things to work together for the betterment of the country. He was also a man of many contrasts and paradoxes. Henry Clay Jr., his son, my great-great-great-great-grandfather, was educated at West Point and served as a lieutenant colonel in the Army. But as a child, Henry Clay Jr. Was actually a schoolmate of one young man called Jefferson Davis. And they knew each other from boyhood, and they ended up serving together in the Mexican-American War. And my ancestor, Henry Clay Jr., was killed in the Battle of Buena Vista. And it was actually Jefferson Davis who collected Henry Clay Jr.'s body and, out of respect for his father, brought him back to Ashland in Kentucky and paid his respects and said, "I'm sorry, here's your son." Now, it's interesting because at the same time, Abraham Lincoln continued throughout his career and to the day he died to consider Henry Clay his beau ideal of a statesman. And he kept a portrait of Henry Clay on his mantelpiece, including at the White House. There was one on the White House mantelpiece when Lincoln was assassinated. And this sort of weird ability to appeal to people of lots of different backgrounds, lots of different views, and work with them effectively, I think is why we call him such a great statesman. And so I wanted to share some thoughts about statesmanship. And I was a finalist for the Rhodes Scholarship when I was 18 years old. I was the youngest candidate ever from the state of Maryland. And I had prepared an essay that talked about justice and cultural issues. And when I walked into the interview, I was actually blindsided by some simple questions. What is your definition of justice? What is your definition of culture? And unfortunately, at the time, I had a definition for neither. But it has made me very fond of defining terms and at least working towards a definition. And we talk about statesmanship often. It's in the papers. It's in public discourse. It's heralded as what we need or what we lack or what will solve a problem. But rarely do we sit down and take a conscious attempt to define it. And since I kept hearing throughout my childhood that Henry Clay was a great statesman, and there are books that have been published, Statesman for the Union, I wanted to try to tease out a little bit of what it means, both historically and today. There is a core, there's a character, there's a depth to it that being a politician or being a politician for a long time or compromising doesn't quite capture. Politicians are often, at this point, celebrities of a sort. And celebrities are often media-made and media-maintained. But statesmen tend not to really have anything to do with visible public images, necessarily. They have something to do with a core accomplishment that they're seeking. And I found a quote that I think gets us a little bit closer to what I hope will be ultimately at the end of the night a definition that we might all come to. But it's from a gentleman called James Freeman Clark. It's probably not a name that many recognize. But he was from Massachusetts. He was educated at Boston Latin, where my actual grandfather was educated. He was then educated at Harvard, where none of my family were educated. He was then he then moved to Kentucky, where he actually became both a minister and a theologian. And he said, and I quote, "A politician thinks of the next election, a statesman of the next generation." And I think that's getting a little bit closer, because I think As I stand before you as a descendant of Henry Clay, he is my ancestor. But in some way, when I talk about Henry Clay to other people, I actually feel like everybody shares him as an ancestor. There is a sense that he is an American ancestor to all of us, and he gave himself to this country. He cared more about this country than himself or than his family, and not in a bad way. And so when looking at statesmanship, I started to realize that I think what made Henry Clay a statesman is that he cared more about America today than many of the people who sit in office today. And I think that's what makes him so remarkable as a historical figure and as a statesman. In the 1960s, and actually for several decades now, the Senate has conducted a review of senators, great statesmen of the past. And Henry Clay remains one of the top five of all time. That's pretty remarkable, given that we've had quite a few. And I think that it is that notion that he was perhaps not the most brilliant. He was perhaps not the most, quote unquote, successful politician, but everybody knew that he cared so deeply about this country that he was willing to put everything on the line. He came out of retirement several times. He kept trying to retire. He wanted out of public life. And yet he kept coming back because he felt that what he needed to do was more important than his own rest, his own retirement, and that he was uniquely poised to help the country. I think I want to end by taking a crack at a definition, but what I'd like to do is hopefully open up the floor to a broader discussion and hear your views, answer questions, maybe share more stories. I will attempt my working definition, and this is an ongoing exercise for me that I doubt will ever ultimately conclude. But a statesman, to me, at this point, is an individual who, in adeptly exercising a public function, remains steadfastly committed to placing public good above personal gain. It's somewhat trite. It doesn't quite capture it. But it does at least get us past some of the notions of compromise, time in service, and skillful politics, which are often about getting ahead rather than actually advancing a cause. So I just end with a prayer, really, that we return to a place where all of us as voters perhaps emphasize more the characteristics of people who, in exercising their public function, are more interested in America and in their and in our greater good than they are in their own personal interests and personal gain. I think we've come to a time where that is extremely important. We're not at an easy juncture in American history. I see it in all sorts of ways, the coal face out abroad and at home. I really hope that in the coming years, we can start to value motivation more than perhaps image or flair. So I hope that gives you a glimpse into Henry Clay, both as a politician and as a statesman, but also as a person. I am very proud of the legacy that I have inherited. It's one that I think is complicated, but it is very appealing in that it is something that I can continue to learn from, and I hope that others will share with me. And I hope that tonight you all will share with me in continuing to hone my understanding of my ancestor and his legacy to our country. So thank you very much, and I look forward to our discussion.